Hello friends, welcome to the EduSat Network. Our today's topic of discussion is environment changes in Himalayan highlands with special reference to glacier changes. And we discuss this topic with our subject expert today, Dr. Suraj Mal, Assistant Professor, Department of Geography, Shaheed Bhagat Singh College, University of Delhi. And his specialization includes mountain environment. And with this, let us welcome him and request him to begin our today's lecture. Thank you for coming, sir.
Thank you very much for having me here. And I now start the lecture. As I have been introduced, my name is Suraj Mal and I am from Shaheed Bhagat Singh College. And I work basically in the Himalayan Highlands. So this was basically the work I have been doing for last 7, 8 years or 10 years in the highlands of the Himalaya, particularly the Uttarakhand region. So today I'll talk about the environmental changes in the Himalayan highlands with special reference to glacier change. So let us first discuss what is the high altitude environment and particularly what is the environment. Basically, the environment is the sum of the conditions that surround us. It includes living things, non-living things, biotic things, abiotic things. So whatever surround us, sunlight, air, water, birds, insects, everything. The combination of all these things is the environment. So these things have changed over the years, and the change is the natural part of the evolution. We know it. But what has happened especially in the last century, 21st century and 20th century, because of the human activities, industrialization, urbanization, high population growth, and vehicular population increase, and pollution increase, there have been major changes, accelerated changes in the environment. So these accelerated changes have been beyond the adaptation capacity of the human. So these have now become the problem. Today I particularly talk about the glacier changes, because this has been the topic of debate at least in last 20 years. Major commissions have been set up. We also have in India the action plan for the climate change and the glaciers by the government of India. We also have had so far the IPCC's 5 reports. IPCC means the Intergovernmental Panel on Climatic Change. And the last report, which was 2007, it was the 4th assessment report, and it was heavily criticized for overestimating some of the retreat of the glaciers. For example, the Gangotri glaciers was told that it will diminish in next 30 years. So, but later on it was found that it is not receding at the rate it was expected or it was told in the previous studies. It was just 15 meters or 20 meters per year. So the situation is not actually that alarming as have been told in the previous researches. So I basically today deal with all these things. So this is basically the conceptual framework for me. As you can see in this slide, this is the glacier surface in the 19th century. And in the 19th century, glaciers were having the maximum extent. But in the last 150 years and 200 years, these glaciers have retreated. You can see this is the current state of the glacier. So earlier, the glacier was somewhere here, and now it has reached this particular point. So there has been glacial retreat, the area vacation has been there, and there has been also the changes in the depth of the glacier. So when glacier retreat, it actually leaves some of the debris. We call it the terminal moraine somewhere here. And when the glaciers are retreated, these are the river is basically blocked by the terminal moraine. You can see over here. So when these rivers are blocked, these become the lakes. We call them glacial lakes or the moraine dammed lake. These are also known as the supraglacial lake and proglacial lakes. So sometime what happens, for example, this is the current state of the glacier. So sometimes debris slides to the lake, sometimes the ice itself slides down to the lake, and then there are some waves produced in this particular lake. And sometimes these lakes can overtop the moraine and can reach the settlements of the downstream. And sometime what can happen that this particular moraine that actually blocked the river, it can breach out. And then this entire water of the moraine dammed lake will go down and will create lot of problems in the downstream. And we have had lot of examples of such lake failures in the Indian Himalaya in the recent times. One of the examples is that in the 2013, last year, in the month of June, the above the Kedarnath, there was a glacial lake called the Vasuki Lake. It breached out and it could create lot of damage. I will show you in the details when I go ahead. Okay, this is the another conceptual framework for me. When there are positive changes in the, there is global warming, so then there are two types of changes, vertical change of the ecosystem and the horizontal change of the ecosystem. In the mountains, we particularly have the vertical changes in the ecosystem. So you can see that this is a altitudinal gradation. In the lower altitudes, we have forests, then we have shrubs in the higher altitudes, then alpine plants, and then the glaciers. But when the global warming takes place, when the glacier disappear from the high altitude, then the area of the glacier is occupied by the alpine plants. And then the alpine plants area was occupied by the shrubs and then by the forest. So what happens? Ultimately, there is the upward shift or the vertical shift of the ecosystems. And sometime when the cooling takes place, then there will be the lowering of the ecosystem. That means the area which was earlier covered by the shrubs will now be covered by the alpine plants and further with the glaciers. So now I tell you the world distribution of the surface area of the small glaciers across the world. You can see in this particular map that the Canadian Arctic, it has the maximum number of small glaciers in the world, followed by the Central Asia and the Alaska. Central Asia, this particular area is the Himalayan area, okay, and this is the largest glacial ice that we have outside the polar regions. So it is very, very important, not just because it is the second largest glacial area, glacial ice, but also because it caters nearly 50% of the world's population. We have a population in India, Bangladesh, Nepal, and also Pakistan and the China, and these countries together have nearly 50%. So 50% of the world's population depend on the water supply from the Himalayan regions. We have major river systems coming out of the Central Asian Himalayan region. For example, we have Indus river system, we have Ganges river system, we have Brahmaputra, we have on the others, the north of the Himalaya, we have the Yellow river system. So there are major systems, river systems. So as I told you that in the recent years, at least in last century, there have been major retreat. So this particular slide talks about the retreat of the glaciers across the world. You can see that during 1960 to 2004, there was negative mass balance. It was minus 283. And if you divide this particular part, 1960 to 2004, from 1960 to 1990 and 1990 to 2004, you can see that in the later half of the study period, the glacial loss, it actually increased. So it actually talks about the accelerated warming led the retreat. So it is going to be a serious problem in the times to come if it continues in that particular manner. So this is the current status of the glaciers, their area and the ice volume in the Himalayan region. And these are the sources for that particular table. We have all the glaciers from Bhutan, India, Nepal, China and Pakistan. And the Indian states do not include in this particular table the northeastern states. We only have data for Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, these two areas basically, and Sikkim also. You can see that in the India, we have nearly 4,278 glaciers, which cover nearly 8,797 square kilometer area. Pakistan, in this Himalayan chain has the maximum number of glaciers. For example, it has 5,218 glaciers altogether, and it also covers the largest glacier area, which is more than 15,000 square kilometer. So in total, we have nearly 15,000 glaciers in the Himalayan region, and the total area is more than 33,000 square kilometers. So we have so many glaciers, and all of them are retreating. The problem is, if these disappear in the time to come, in next 20 years, 30 years, or 100 years, this is going to be a problem, as has been mentioned in IPCC report 2007. This is the slide that has been taken from the journal called Science, and this was the paper published by Bolsch et al. And they basically collected the data from all the possible studies that have been done in the Indian Himalayan region and the Karakoram region, and they basically concluded that most of the Himalayan glaciers are retreating, but the change or the retreat rate varies from one area to the other. You can see this blue circle, this is about the area changes. You can see that in the Karakoram region, the size of the circle is little smaller than these particular circles. So this is little bigger. That means the glaciers in this particular area have not retreated with the rate at they have been retreated in this particular part, in the Sikkim, in the Nepal, in the Uttarakhand, and also in the Himachal Himalaya. This is the table that I have compiled from various sources. You can see there are a number of references that I have quoted, and they have discussed the glacial retreat nearly for a century. We have Siachen glaciers that in the western side of the Himalaya, the retreat rate has been nearly about 32 meters per year. For the Milam glacier, we have had varying retreat rate from nearly 13 meters per year during 1849 to 1906, and that increased to nearly 16 meters in 1906 to 1938. And from 1968 to 1997, the glacial retreat rate was around 30.3 meters per year. So you can conclude that the Milam glacier also experienced the accelerated retreat. And the recent estimate talks about that during the period of 1990 to 2006, the retreat rate was around 37 meters per year, which is very, very high as compared to the other Himalayan glaciers like Gangotri or Tipra or Yamunotri glacier or Zemu glacier. And the other glaciers like Chorabari in Uttarakhand, it has retreated with the around 10 meters per year. Then Dokrani glaciers around 18 meters per year in the recent past. Gangotri during 1935 to 1971, it retreated with the rate of around 27 meters per year. And in the recent past, it is told that it retreated about 17 meters per year during 1971 to 2004. This was the major concern in the recent time, because it was told that the glacier of the Gangotri will disappear in the next coming 30 years. So it is going to be a serious problem, because not just the population is living there, because there are number of dams that are there being constructed, and they are planned also in the time to come. And if the glacier disappear, the river will disappear, and if the river disappear, what is the fate of these dams? What will happen to these dams? We expect a lot of these dams, energy production, and other water supply issues in the water deficit season, for example, in summers. So if the river is not there, what is going to be the future of the electricity in the northern India? What is going to be the future of the water supply in the northern India? So this was the major concern, and it was later found that it wasn't as high as told. I will deal this with this particular point later on. And then there are some other glaciers. For example, we have Tipra glacier, which retreated at the rate of around 12 meters per year from 1960 to 1986, and the rate of the retreat accelerated with around 13.4 meters during 1962 to 2002, And in the recent time, you see that the retreat was around 21 meters per year during 2002 to 2008. So most of these glaciers have experienced the accelerated retreat. But the another important thing is that the rate varies. It is not that all the glaciers are retreating with a very high rate. For example, the CEC-UGC 31 or for example the Milam 37 meters per year. At the same time, we have the glaciers like Donagiri, which was almost stationary for few years. And the study by Swaroop et al. And Srivastava et al. During 1985 to 1997, they found that for few years there was positive mass balance, for few years the glacier also advanced few meters, and sometime it also retreated. So they concluded that it was almost stationary. So we have variety of experience that we have for all the glaciers. On the other side, we have Chota Sikri glacier that could only experience 7.6 meters per year retreat rate during 1970 to 1989. So there are lot of variations. Then this is the net mass balance recorded for some of the major Himalayan glaciers, and it is in the meter water equivalent. You can see that most of the figures are in the negative. For example, this one, this is the Nehnar glacier, and the negative mass balance was minus 0.41, and it has always shown the negative mass balance. At the same time, we have had the negative mass balance for the Donagiri glacier, negative mass balance for the Tipra glacier, Chota Sikri glacier, and the Dokrani glacier. They never experienced any positive mass balance. But in two cases, Gara glacier and Gorgang glacier, there have been, and of course Shon Garang glacier, there have been few years when there was positive mass balance. That means there was no retreat recorded for that particular year, but there was also the advancement. There was the ice gain during those years. For example, in 1974 to 75, the Gara, and 75-76, in both these years the Gara glacier recorded the positive sign, and same goes to 1981 and 1982. Okay, so this is the diagrammatic representation of the how glaciers looks like actually. And when we think of glacier, we always believe that it will be the white ice, white snow, but it is not the case always. Some around 70% or 60% in some cases, and in some cases 100% of the glacier is covered with the debris. So what we actually think, believe about the glacier, they do not look like same. So we have few terminologies, few zones we should understand before we go to the further discussion. This is the diagrammatic representation of the glacier, and this lower zone is known as the ablation zone. Ablation zone means this is the zone of the ice loss. Because of the process of melting, there is always the loss of the ice. But on the other side, you have the accumulation zone. Accumulation zone is the zone where each year some snow accumulates and it becomes ice later on. So because of the precipitation, snowfall, there is always accumulation. So between the two zones, accumulation zone and the ablation zone, there is a zone where there is no gain of the ice and there is no loss of the ice. And this zone is known as the ELA, basically the equilibrium line altitude. And it is basically the snow line at the end of the ablation season or at the end of the hydrological year. So we also have the fern line. Fern is basically the snow that could survive the last hydrological year. For example, if there is snowfall taking place this year and in the winters, and it can survive the next summer season. So for example, in the Indian Himalaya, the summer season is between May, June, July, August. So if the snow can survive these 4 months, then it becomes fern for the next year. So, and in the time to come, the fern become ice through the process of the crystallization. And this is the Google Earth image, and this is the area that I have surveyed for my researches in the recent times. And the diagrammatic representation of the glacier that I made, now we have the near natural or near real world situation of the glacier, and it is on the basis of the Google Earth image. You can see that these two are the accumulation zone, and the glacier basically starts from this particular point to this direction. This is the accumulation zone, and then there is a tributary of this glacier from here to this particular zone. So it has a main valley glacier and then another tributary glacier. Okay, so this is the accumulation zone where there is the snow accumulation every year. This is the ablation zone where there is always ice loss, and between the two there is this particular point. You can see this is the ELA that I mentioned earlier in the last slide. It is the equilibrium line altitude, and it coexists with the snow line at the end of the hydrological year, which is the late September in the Uttarakhand Himalaya. So you can, as I also mentioned, that the glacier do not always appear white snow, and the lower side of the glacier are most of the time covered with the debris. You see in this particular area we do not have any white patch, it is all snow instead. It is the ice is under the debris, and this is the ablation zone also, and somewhere here is the snout. I will also show the photographs of all the regions, all these parts. Okay, this is the field photograph. I visited this particular area in 2010, and I could take the photograph of this particular point. I started my survey from this particular point, and then I followed this cursor flow line, and then I crossed this particular pass, and then I went to the other valley. So this was my survey route in 2010. So you see, this is the photo of this particular point. I hope you can make out. Then this is the accumulation zone, and there is sudden change of the slope over here. So beyond, above this particular ELA, you have clean ice, and below this particular point, you have the debris cover, and between the two, you have the ELA plus snow line. That means above that you have accumulation zone, and below that you have the ablation zone. Okay, now this is the photograph of the little lower region. You can see the common area between the Google Earth image and the real photo. You can see that the ablation zone is covered by the heavy debris, and there are sudden changes in the slopes in the ablation zone. It is because the lower regions, for example this one, is experiencing higher melting than in the upper regions. This is a debris covered ablation zone, as I told you, and these are the two lateral moraines. Lateral moraines are those moraines which are found on the both the sides of the glacier in the direction of the flow, and these can be one indication on the basis of which we can say if the glacier is melting or it is not melting. So we experienced very high ridges, and these ridges of the moraine, lateral moraine, indicate the Little Ice Age. So we can say that from the Little Ice Age, it was nearly in 1700, and till date the glacier has retreated nearly 20 meters in the upper ablation zone. So this is the photograph of the little lower region. You can see there are major cracks. I hope you can make out. There are major cracks, and we call them crevasses. And in this particular ablation zone, this glacier has become like the empty house. You have the surface, and beneath this there is nothing. There is no ice, there is only the bedrock. So it can demolish any time under the scenario of the climatic change. So what we see from the satellite image is sometimes it is not the true representation of the glacier retreat. So sometimes the field work is very, very important. So on the basis of the field work, we could make out that there is much more retreat of the glacier than we could anticipate from the analysis of the satellite images. Okay, then this is the lower ablation zone. This is the area which is very close to the snout position, and you can see that there are high ridges. For example, this one, this is the right lateral moraine and this is the left lateral moraine, on the basis of which we can say, okay, the glacier has retreated, and then this is the snout position. I hope many of you have seen the Gomukh, which is the snout of the Gangotri region, and snout is the position from where the river emerges. So this is the Lakshman Ganga river, basically from the Valley of Flowers National Park, that emerges in the from the Tipra glacier. It is quite similar condition to the Gangotri glacier that we have. Okay, so this was the true representation of the glacier. Then we tried to survey some of the glaciers and estimate the retreat rate. For that we did a case study in the Uttarakhand Himalaya in the Nanda Devi Biosphere Reserve. So it is, the Nanda Devi Biosphere Reserve is located in the Uttarakhand state, and it spreads over the three districts, Chamoli, Bageshwar and Pithoragarh, and it has two World Heritage Sites, the Nanda Devi National Park and the Valley of Flowers National Park. And the Biosphere Reserve is listed in the World Network of the Biosphere Reserves. So it is very, very important Biosphere Reserve. So these are the altitudinal zones of the Nanda Devi Biosphere Reserve. As you can see that the altitude varies from 7,799 meters to 1,416 meters. So these are the different altitudinal ranges. You can see that most of the region is above the 3000 meters height. You can see from 3000 meters to 4000 meters, it is about 18% of the total area. From 4000 meters to the 5000 meters, it is about 37% of the total area. And from 5000 meters to 6000 meters, about 33% of the total area. So nearly 85-90% of the Nanda Devi Biosphere Reserve is located more than the 3100 meters above mean sea level, which is very high altitudinal area. So this is the methodology that we adopted for the study of the glaciers. We did the collection of both the types of data. We also collected the primary data, we also collected the secondary data. Primary data was collected using the field visits, as I already mentioned. I did some survey aided by the GPS, and the secondary data basically included the research reports, research papers, and the topographical sheets of Survey of India, and the Corona satellite images, ASTER images from 2005, and Landsat images of Landsat 5, Landsat 7 and Landsat 8. We did the analysis using the software called ERDAS and ArcGIS. We compared the different extent using the mapping. I mean to say, we did the mapping on different satellite images, different topographical sheets for different years, and then we compared them if the glaciers are retreating or they are not retreating, or what is the change rate. So these are these photographs from my field. You can see that we did the survey in the accumulation zone in the Nanda Devi region. So this is one feature which is prominent in the accumulation zone. And these are the photographs from the Bankund Glacier, which is the base camp for the Mana Peak. And this is the survey team. Yes, and this is the very important point that I would like to highlight over here, is that when we conduct survey, we have to undergo very difficult conditions. We sometimes undergo physical changes, biological changes, mental changes. You see, there was a storm one night and most of the things got washed away. You see, this one of the tents that did not work properly. So there are always constraints in the glaciological researches. So these are the survey trails over the years that I have conducted. I have been conducting this survey from 2006, then I again went in 2008, 2009, 10 and 11. So these are different survey trails for Donagiri Glacier, this for the Milam Glacier in the the Laftal zone, and this is the Valley of Flowers area, Badrinath area, Mana area. So these are the different survey trails that I have done. So this is the description of the satellite images and the topographical sheets. Okay, when we compared the earlier topographical sheets and the recent satellite images and the aerial photographs, we found for the three glaciers we sampled, we found that the Tipra glacier retreated, this is the change in the area, about 0.54 square kilometer from 1962 to 2010, and the length changed from 7.58 kilometers to 7.18 kilometers in 2010. So same way the mean width also changed. The altitudinal shift we also could notice, there was the altitudinal shift of around 60 meters during the said period. Same way you can see that Donagiri glacier also retreated, there is a change of 0.03 square kilometer area, and the length could also go down around 60 meters during the said period of 1962 to 2008. And same way the Milam glacier also changed, the length changed around 1.5 6 kilometers during 1962 to 2009, and the total reduction in the area was around 1.66 square kilometer. So these are the diagrammatic representation of the change of the snout position of the Milam glacier, Tipra glacier and Donagiri glacier. Okay, these are the field photographs of the three glaciers. We can see that the Donagiri glacier retreated around 1.3 meter per year during 1962 to 2008, which is very very low, which is almost negligible. But on the other side we have Tipra glacier that retreated around 12.5 meter per annum during 1962 to 2010, which is also not a major area of concern. But we had the retreat of the Milam glacier with 29 meters per annum during 1962 2009. It was a major problem because such a high rate is not, we do not expect such a high rate of the glacier, but since it is taking place, it is a major concern for the time to come, as for the reasons I told you earlier, there is a lot of population living downstream, there are number of dams that are involved. Okay, these are the field photographs I showed you, this is the indication of the glacial retreat. Again, this is the indication of glacial retreat. This photo I also mentioned earlier. Okay, what happened when there was overestimation of the Gangotri glacier, that it was told that it is retreating around 40 meters rate per year. So it was reanalyzed by many scientists if it was really so, because major groups across the world, for example in the Zurich University or in the JNU, they told that it is not retreating at the same rate as it has been told. So they could do some reanalysis using the, they actually avoided the topographical sheet because they knew, or they came with the conclusion that there are some problems with the snout position marking in the topographical sheets. So they Bambri et al., they published a paper in 2012 in the Current Science Journal, and they said that the actual retreat rate is around 20 meters per year during 1965 to 2006, and it never crossed 27 meters per year. But the recent, but the earlier researches, for example this one 1962 2006, they revealed that the glacier retreated around 38 meters per year. In 1962 to 2000, the glacier retreated around 40 meters per year, which was the major area of concern at that time. And this was the major criticism on the basis of which IPCC was criticized. So they analyzed the Bambri et al. Reanalyzed the Gangotri glacier, and they concluded that it is retreating only at this particular rate. Okay, we also followed the same principle. We avoided the use of this topographical sheet, and we replaced the topographical sheet of 1962 by the corona image of the 1968. And we found that We also did another analysis. Most of the time when we compare the different snout position, we talk about only the active snout positions. We do not talk about all the glacial margins that are retreating. We only talk about just one particular point, and then we conclude if the glacier is retreating. So this is sometimes not a very good representation of the retreat. So what we did, we laid down the stripes with 50 meters distance, and we averaged the retreat. So to us, it was the true representation of the glacial retreat. So then we came up with the conclusion that the Milam glacier retreated during 1968 to 2013 at the rate of 37.26 meters per year. But when we talk about only the active snout position, then it was 36 meters per year. So there is always a difference when you talk just about the active snout position or when you talk about the total retreat. So total retreat is much more better than the retreat of the active snout position. Then you can see that this is the table that shows the area vacation or area vacated by the glacier ice. Total ice loss has been around, the total area has been about 1412 square kilometer between 1968 to 2013. We also tried to find out some of the common points between the earlier corona images of 1968 and the current satellite image of the Landsat at. You see that these are the common points over here, and this is the active snout position in 1968, and this is the current snout position of the 2013. So if we transfer the snout position of 1968 to the current satellite image, so it should be somewhere here. So snout position has retreated from this particular point to this particular point. So much of the length has been, or so much of the area has been retreated. In addition to that, there have been some morphological changes. For example, there are new lakes that have been developed in the foreland of the glacier. As I told you in the very beginning, that these are known as the supraglacial lake or proglacial lake sometimes, or end moraine dammed lake. So these are two glacial lakes that we found in 2009 fieldwork. So this is another example from the Milam glacier only. In the upper regions, we found that this particular tributary was serving the ice to the main valley glacier in 1968, and it is on the basis of the corona image. But the analysis of the 2013 satellite image suggests that there is no flow anymore from the tributary glacier. That means it has detached. You can see there is a morphological changes, and now there is a small river. So it has detached and it is not serving the ice, or there is no flow towards the main glacier. It is another example from the right tributary glacier. You see, in 1968, there was the major ice that could come to the main valley. But now, this particular width, it has now decreased. In the 1968, it was nearly 250 meters wide contribution to the main valley, but now it has reduced to the 150 meter almost. It talks about the retreat of the glaciers in the recent times. Then we applied the same concept to 30 glaciers in that particular Mandadevi massive region. And on the basis of the 30 glaciers, we found that the glaciers retreat rate vary. There are some glaciers that have retreated around 8.3 meters per year in the recent time of 2001 to 2013. For example, Gangphoki glacier, and then you have Milam glacier that could retreat around 34 meters per year. Then there is Batharthuli glacier, which has retreated around 20 meters per year. And same way, we have Poting glacier that receded with the rate of 30 meters per year, and we also have the tributary glaciers of the Nanda Devi main glacier, which could retreat by 8.4 meters per year. So there are special variations. So why there are special variations in the retreat? There is a question now. We tried to explain these relations on the basis of the, or these special variations on the basis of the area of the glaciers, snout elevation, length of the glaciers. Earlier we believed up to 2010 that the snout positions which are located at the lower altitude have experienced higher retreat rate, and the snout positions which are located at the higher elevations have retreated with the lower retreat rate. So we actually believed that there is a strong correlation between the snout elevation and the retreat rate. The regression analysis suggests that the snout elevation can only explain about 13% of this relation. Then we talked about, we established the relationship between the area of the glacier and the retreat rate. The area of the glacier could explain nearly 7.4% of the total retreat, and together the snout elevation and area could not explain larger part of the retreat. So we also talked about the length of the glacier, and it could only explain very less. So altogether we have very less explanation for why there is so much of the special variations based on the snout elevation, area and length of the glaciers. We believe that there are some other factors also that can have, that can play a major role in deciding the behavior of a glacier. For example, the debris cover, how much area is covered by the debris, because debris sometimes act as the, they act as the, as they are protecting the ice from melting, because there is no direct connection of the insolation, that is incoming solar radiation, with the ice. So they preserve the ice sometimes. So, and there can be another important factor, which is the aspect of the slope. What is the orientation of the glacier? Is it the north facing glacier or is it the south facing glacier? South facing glaciers are exposed to direct sun rays for longer time of the day, so they retreat much more than the glaciers which are oriented to the north side, because they do not have large time of the day that they are exposed to the sunshine. So as I told you in the very beginning, in the first slide, when the glacial retreat, it leaves some moraine in the forefront, and sometimes they block the river, and then there is development of the glacial lake. So, and these glacial lakes are major problem because they sometimes breach, they create havoc in the downstream areas. So we collected the primary and secondary data for the analysis of the glacial lake. We went to the field for collecting the primary data, and secondary data included the Landsat images from the MSS and thematic mapper, and the analysis was done using the ArcGIS. We mapped the glacial lakes for 1976 and 2010, and then we compared the glacial extent, the extent of the glacial ice, sorry. And these are the details of the satellite images that I used. This is the spatial distribution of the glacial lakes in Nanda Devi region. These blue dots represent the glacial lakes. Basically, these lakes may appear very small in the larger satellite image, but these are very big lakes. And sometimes the glacial lakes are not appearing very big on the surface because they have the water beneath the ice. So how much water is there beneath the ice, sometimes it becomes a problem to understand. So when they breach out, they create lot of problems that we will see in the time to come. Okay, these are the this is the basically the distribution area and types of the glacial lakes in Nanda Devi region. And we did the classification of the glacial lakes. This is the typology of the glacial lakes on the basis of the types. So we characterized the glacial lakes into cirque lake, end moraine, damped lake, lateral moraine, damped lake, supraglacial lakes, and the other. And of the total 35 glacial lakes that we could map, three are very high altitude glacial lakes. They are located more than 5,000 meters above mean sea level. 11 are located between 4,500 meters to 5,000 meters. And 14 lakes are located between 4,000 meters to 4,500 meters and 7 below 4,000 meters. These are the different lakes that we could photograph in the field. This is the example of the Sark Lake, and this is the very famous lake because there is a very famous Sikh shrine, that is the Hemkund Sahib over here. And this is the right lateral moraine dammed lake. This is a Bankund Lake in the Bankund Glacier area, and these are the two glacial lakes which are found in the forefront of the Milam Glacier, and the photograph of which I also showed you earlier. Okay, as I told you that we compared the extent of 1970s and the recent times of 2010. We could not compare the area of old glacial lakes because of the spatial resolution differences of the MSS image and the Landsat image, but we could compare few major glacial lakes. We found that, you see that this is the area, this is a column that shows the area of the glacial lakes in 1976, and this is the column that shows the area of the glacial lakes in 2010, and this is showing the change over the period. You see that all of the area of all the glacial lakes has increased. For example, Kag Bhusandi, this is one important glacial lake, the Sitkeng glacial lake, this is a major glacial lake, this which is coming up in the forefront of the Kamet glacier. People have not given so much of thought to this particular glacial lake, but this is a very, very big lake, and if it breaches out, it can be a major problem up to the area of the Srinagar. And then there are other lakes like Geldhura and Satopand Lake. Okay, this is the lake that I was just talking about, which is the in front of the Kamet Glacier. This is the extent in 1976, and now you see many of the such glacial lakes have come together and they have formed one big glacial lake. And in the downstream areas of these regions, they have number of settlements. So if this particular glacial lake breach out, it can be a serious problem. So this is the other example of the glacial lake. This is also a Sark lake, and it is, the name of the glacial lake is the Kag Bhusandi. It is also another dangerous glacial lake. You see that there is a continuous debris slide zone over here, and this area is common. Okay, and sometime there is avalanche that is taking place, sometime there is landslide, debris flow taking place, and these avalanches or this mass movement create waves in this lake, and this lake, sometime this water can overtop this particular outlet. This is the outlet for this particular glacial lake, and there are number of settlements downstream which can be, they can be devastated anytime if it breaches. So these lakes are problem, these have to be monitored time to time. Okay, you see this is the Kag Bhusandi lake, that the photograph of which was shown in the last slide. This is the another Hemkund lake, and this is another lake, and these are the settlements. This is Bhindar settlement here, this is Pulna village, Govind Ghat, and number of other settlements which are there in the downstream. If any of the stream or any of the glacial lake breach out, it can be a problem. It is one example when in 2003 a glacial lake breached out and it devastated every single house in the village. This is a village, and this is a photograph of 2002. There was a glacial lake upstream, and there is a village over here. And before 2002, there was a small stream coming down, but in 2002 the lake breached and it devastated few houses of the village, but the people of the village did not give much attention to it and they stayed there. But what happened in 2003? This is a picture of 2003. Every single house was devastated by the breaching out of this glacial lake. You can see these are the two common points on the basis of which you can make out that the entire village, this was the village over here, and now it has been buried by the debris cover. So these glacial lakes can be a major problem, and it is clear from this particular slide. And this happened last year on 16 to 17 June in the Kedarnath. Of course, it was not just the glacial lake breaching, there was this rainfall also involved. But what happened, it was the extreme rainfall in 2 or 3 days, and it melted the snow of the glacier which was just above this shrine, and there was then too much of water in the glacial lake and it breached, and then entire Kedarnath and the other settlements downstream, they were destroyed. This is the photo of the pre-disaster stage and this is the photo of the post-disaster stage. So you can see the devastation of the Kedarnath town. Okay, this is another photo from the field. I told you about the Pulna village in this slide. This is the Pulna village and Govind Ghat. So the slide to come is from this particular point. You see, last year only this entire village got washed out. There was no single house left. Because of the extreme rainfall and snowfall and the too much of the water coming out of the glacial lake, the entire village washed out, and there was lot of damage, lot of loss of the property and the animals, pets and so on. This is another example of what happened last year. Because of the extreme rainfall and combined with the glacial lake breaching, we were there in the Himachal Pradesh, and this is a photograph of the Tapri place. When you go to Kinnaur from Shimla, then this is a place in between. So there was lot of damage. You can see hotels, houses, everything got damaged. So thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for talking so much in depth about glacier changes and also giving us various different examples. And with that regard, sir, I'd like to ask you a question. Say, you were talking about glaciers that retreat, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but Siachen glacier is the one that has retreated the most, mm-hmm. the most in terms of meters.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Actually, there are different databases that have been used, and this particular Siachen glacier was assessed on the basis of the comparison of the earlier topographical sheets,
right,
and the current satellite images. But in the case of the Gangotri, there was the mismatch about the snout position in 1962. So if we, let's say, talk about the corona image of the 1968 and we avoid using the topographical sheet, there can be correct picture. So we still have to understand the anomalies, the inaccuracies of the topographical sheets. So this is very important thing, and what I showed, it was just on the basis of the literature review,
right,
which was based on
the basis of studies other people have done.
Yes.
Also, sir, you talked about the same thing, that glaciers retreat. So what is the biggest danger of glaciers retreating?
See, major issues are already understood. If the glacial retreat, what is the future of the dams? Because there are major dams coming on the river banks of Ganges, Yamuna and other rivers. If the glacier retreat, there will be no water, and if there is no water, what will we do of these dams? They will be of no use.
Right.
So this is one issue. Then we have the issue of the water supply in the summer season, because the water is stored in the dams and then it is supplied during the water deficit season of the summer. But if the glaciers will not be there, of course it is not going to happen in near future, like 20 years or 30 years or 50
right.
years. It takes time.
Takes time, definitely.
The temperature changes that are taking place today, these will be reflected in terms of the glacial retreat after 20 years or 30 years. So there is always a time lag, which we have not been able to understand so far.
Right.
So there is still a lot of gap between the scientific community.
Right. Sir, you also talked about glacier thinning. So mm-hmm. can you explain the term a bit
okay.
more?
Glacier thinning is, see, there are two types of changes in the glacier. One, there is reduction in the area of the glacier. Other is, there is change in the depth.
Okay.
So both the things take place at the same time.
Right.
Okay, when I talk about glacial thinning, that means there is a change in the glacial depth like this.
Right. Thank you so much, sir. And we again should thank sir for being here and for talking about this topic in depth of changes in glaciers in the environment, a very relevant topic. If we want to survive and have a good environment around us, we must take care of it. And with that, we shall close our today's lecture. Thank you for watching. Have a nice day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.